So we'll start in 2 minutes. Guess we have a low count today. Yesterday like 15-20 people joined. Okay guys, time is 8:05, so we can start, I guess. So just confirm me if you all can hear me and see my screen. Just you can unmute once and then say yes. Hello.
Okay.
Before we start, a major disclaimer, like my name is Sai Sudharan and I'm running a software company, and the thing is, like, I'm more into software thing, but I'm not an expert in finance or economics or anything. But the thing is, like, I have been following the space, Bitcoin space, for almost more than 4 years, like from the mid of 2017, like on the technical aspects, on the political aspects, on the economic aspects, and so many things, and I have learned a lot actually. And so it's my personal learning only which I am going to share now. Okay, so don't take whatever I am going to say as a professional investment advice and then do any investments based on this webinar. Okay, so always consult your auditor and other professionals before you do any actual investment. Okay, and then another major disclaimer, like Bitcoin is just not just a investment economic thing. It's a mix of so many sectors, like it's an intersection of politics, economics, distributed systems, cryptography. So it's a huge thing, and whatever is involved is also like brand new. If you take the distributed systems, whatever distributed systems happened before Bitcoin is different, what's happening after Bitcoin is different. Even the economic theories, which was only theories for a long time, is being tried out and then implemented after Bitcoin is launched. So it's a huge thing. So it will be almost impossible for even anyone to take any full week and then even try to explain Bitcoin. But we are going to just touch up the basics too, so you get a good foundation over which you can go and explore yourself through Google, YouTube videos and such. So whatever you are going to learn from this webinar is just the basics of things. Okay, and then this is the today's agenda. So the first going into Bitcoin, we'll be discussing on various problems of why Bitcoin. So what's the problem it is trying to solve? So we'll go through our economic systems, all the problems in that. Like, we'll start with what's currency, and then history of currency, and then history of tax, and then people might have heard of inflation. So we will go through what inflation is and then come to what are the problems that happens because of inflation. And then there is a strong anti-corruption case for Bitcoin, so we'll see that. And then we'll just touch up what Bitcoin is. So once you learned all these things, you will naturally can understand what Bitcoin is, and then we'll also see the investment perspective and also the risks associated with investing in Bitcoin and cryptocurrencies. And then we'll have a huge time for Q&A where you can post all your questions and then we can start. And I'm dedicating this whole session webinar to Mr. Andreas Antonopoulos. Like, I have been also following him from 2017. He's like a born in Greek guy, and but by nationality is a British guy. So he always speaks about the philosophy and purpose of Bitcoin rather than getting excited about the price rise, price drop and all. So he's always to the purpose. So that's why I am following and learned a lot from him. So I will also share the slides with you all once this is over. You can find link to his Twitter page, his website. You can also start following him. Okay. So this is a quote by Henry Ford. If you see here, I have copied it. So what Henry Ford says is it is well enough that people of the nation do not understand our banking and monetary system. For if they did, I believe there will be a revolution before tomorrow morning. So I don't know how many of you people knows about Henry Ford. So he is the founder of automobiles. So before Henry Ford, everyone was traveling in horses. There is no car, there is no bus, nothing. So he is the founder of Ford Motors, the car company. So some 120 years back, he invented the first car in New York. So he's a legend. Like, so he invented automobile industry literally. Okay, so what he says is people don't understand how the banking industry and then the monetary system works. If they understand it, there will be a revolution tomorrow morning. Everyone will come to the street and then they will say change the system, it's all so corrupt and broken. He said it like 120 years back, but the thing is, unfortunately, still it is relevant today. And the thing is, like, it's turned up into even more mess now. So those things we'll look into as we progress. Okay. So yeah, first, before I go to this, first you people now can tell me what is currency. Like, let's say I am a fifth standard kid, I'm a small kid. Okay, I'm curious about what is flower, what is sky. So I'm asking you, what is currency? Can you give me a short answer? Hello. Switch.
I cannot do that. Yeah. Mode of exchange.
Mode of exchange. Yeah, good one. Anything else?
It denotes the value of the product.
It denotes the value of a product. Good one. Mode of exchange denotes the value of a product. Anyone else? Okay, so the second person got a closer definition. So currency is a technology which is used to measure the value of anything. It's not just a product but also a services. Because you are going to see a doctor, he is spending some his skills and time to check up your body. You are coming back. You are not purchasing any product but you are purchasing a service from him, right? So so currency is a technology to measure value of a product or service. You can call it that way. Okay. And then, so if you see, measuring value, currency is a very ancient technology, very, very ancient technology. That the thing is, like, it's even older than writing technology. So writing is a technology, right? Like, we used to start recording things in paper, and now in so many other forms. Like, it started in stones and then paper came, and then now these times and all, we are using digital. Everything we are writing in system, everything is getting digitalized. So writing technology was found way back, like some 10,000 years ago, right? So the first writings, if you see, those are like writings of transactions. Like, I have bought like so many bags of wheat from this guy, and I have gave him some cogs or something for the exchange. So those transactions were recorded, and those were the first writings, which means when they first started writing, they already had a value system with which they are exchanging things. So the barter system I am referring to. So that was invented even before writing. Okay. So like, currencies is such a technology, but we don't understand it much. Like, even now, like, we use currency in our everyday day-to-day life. Everything is somehow touching up the currency concept, but no one can give any two mark definition of currency. We understand what organic compound is, we are taught what is photosynthesis is. We even studied E is equal to MC square, all those derivations, okay, we studied so much, but what is currency, how it is produced, what is inflation, the basics of economics, I believe should be taught to everyone, but it is not taught. So that's a problem. Why? That's another question. So we'll just go through things. So a currency, in the history, if you see, there are so many different forms of currencies, like we used gold, we used copper coins. Like even in ancient tribal period and all, we used shells, seashells and such. So all these different types of currencies go through four stages. Okay, the first stage is a collectible stage. Collectible stage is like, it's not at a currency, but it is something people like to collect and keep it to show, they will be happy to showcase it. For example, you can take a stamp collection. There is like a trump card collection is there. So many other things we even as kids we used to collect things, right? So for a currency, for something to become a currency, the first eligibility criteria is it should check off the collectible phase. So people should see it as a collectible first. And then it should become a store of value, which means if I am collecting and keeping it now in 2020, I should expect it to grow in value in some 5 years, 10 years. So if I am investing some 1,000 rupees in this and then getting some item and then keep it in my home, so I should believe after 5 years I should be selling it for some amount more than 1,000. I should be selling it for 2,000, 3,000, like that. So people are investing in gold and all, right? So that's all a store of value. Like if let's say you are investing in land in the center of a city, okay, where the railway station is, there nearby airport and all. Like let's say you are investing some 1 crore on this, and you are damn sure in some 5-10 years you can sell it for 5 crores or 10 crores. The amount will get multiplied by 5 or 10. So that is the store of value. So for a currency, for an item, for anything to become a currency, it should pass the second stage, which is store of value. And then the third stage is medium of exchange. So you have a land, you have purchased a land for a store of value utility, but then you cannot exchange the land for anything. You cannot use it in a day-to-day transactions, right? So but for gold coins, silver coins, the paper money that we have, those things we are using as a medium of exchange to purchase something, to exchange something, you are using that one, right? So that's the third stage which an item should pass to become the currency. Medium of, if anything is passing the, coming to the medium of exchange stage, it's almost a currency, but it's still not a proper 100% currency. And because the fourth stage it should pass, the fourth stage is like unit of account, which means in the specific society where you are living, in America, Australia or India. So in that society or country, every product, every service should be measured in that item. So if everyone is saying like to buy water, you need to spend, you need to give this water costs this much gold, this product costs this much gold, this service costs this much gold, then gold is the unit of account there. But if everything is measured in rupees, then rupees, in Indian rupees, is the unit of account, that is the currency there. If everything is measured and exchanged, everything is measured in dollars, then in that particular society or country, that the currency is the dollar there. So that is the unit of account stage. Okay. So yeah, before going to the properties of currency, do you have any questions so far? So I guess it's clear. Okay. So let's go to the third property. So just now like think of currency as a product in the market. In the market, you can buy computers, you can buy furniture, you can buy food, you can buy anything, right? So when you are going to market to buy something, like let's say you are going to buy a laptop. So laptop has so many properties. Laptop has a property called RAM, a property called processor, a property called display size, all those things. So you will be comparing different laptops. So this is a 8GB laptop, this is a 16GB laptop, this is i7 processor, this is good, this is 21 inch monitor, this is nice and all, right? So like that, now consider currency as a product. So you have different currencies, you have yuan, you have Indian rupee, you have dollar, and then before we used gold, silver coins and all, right? So to compare each currency, which currency is good for me, for my use case, then you need to compare these properties, right? So the first property is not in order, specific order, but the first property is durable. So durable means if you are buying that currency and then keeping it for how long you can keep it, like whether it will not get destroyed by storm, fire, you run a lorry over it, it will also don't break then. So then it's durable, it won't break, it will sustain everything, every damage it can take. So that is durable. Portable is like how easy it is to transport. So if you want to transport a huge amount of money from Australia to US, so that's like jumping certain number of continents, right? So how easy it is to move things, that is portability. Fungibility is, let's say, different units of a currency. Like I have one 10 rupee note, you have one 10 rupee note, the third person has a 10 rupee note. Is all the 10 rupee notes has an equal value? So that is fungibility. I can explain you with this example why, where, what is the case where fungibility doesn't apply. Let's say there is some smuggler or something who took a kid of a rich person and then asked for, like, you give me some 5 lakh rupees and then I will return you your kid. Okay, and then what the police will do is they will mark the number, serial numbers of those exact 5 lakhs and then put it in a bag and then ask the parents to give those money to the guy who stole the kit. And then everything happens and then the police, the government can track those 5 lakh rupees because they know the serial numbers. And now it's very hard for that guy to go and put it in a bank or something, because the moment it hits any government institution, banking institution, he can be easily tracked. So this guy has went to ICICI bank and trying to deposit there. So now each 1000 rupee note in that 5 lakh rupee is not equal to the regular currency, regular rupee note, because it has some risk associated with it. That's the problem. So the thing is, like, he will probably give that 5 lakhs to different people and then get some low money from that. So that's what fungibility is. And then verifiable. So if you give some 500 rupee note in bank and all, they will put it in some different angles and perspectives and see if it's like a printed note, like if it's normal note or like someone printed it or something. Even in gold, like if you go to some Sarana stores and then somewhere and then give gold to sell it or thing, they will verify it, like whether it has something mixed with that, like copper or something is mixed with it. So how easy it is to verify. So currently, like, as a common man, it's hard to verify, right? So that is verifiability. And then divisibility. So what's the minimum denominator you can go in that currency? Like when it comes to rupees, you can split it into paisa, right? So that's the divisibility. And then scarcity, obviously, something should not be like abundant. Yeah, something which should be used as a currency should not be abundant. If it can be easily acquired, then the value cannot be maintained. It will become so volatile. So suddenly someone produces huge amount of currency and then everything becomes a mess. So scarcity is a needed property. And then obviously established history. If someone is coming and printing and saying, hey, I have invented new currency in my name, so would you like to use it? No one will buy it because it has no history and no trust, nothing. And then censorship resistance is a new property which no other money before Bitcoin has given us. Everything can be censorship, right? So I will go in detail into that later. So Bitcoin is the only currency which gives us this properties of censorship resistance. So put it in one line, I will say, like, so let's say there is an activist, okay? There's an activist who finds some corruptions that is happening inside the government. There's a, he found some huge scam and then he is putting it out, okay? And then the thing what the government immediately what will do is, like, if it's actually a big headache to the government that this information came out, and the possibility of that guy putting out even more in corruption case in public is there, then the first thing that the government will do is, like, arrest that guy. And then the second thing is they will seize his bank accounts, okay? Because physically going and arresting is the topmost thing, but the thing is, like, if he is moved somewhere, if he is in some other jurisdiction, some other country, then you are not physically can do that, right? So in that case, what you do is you freeze every of his bank accounts. Then without any money, currency, you won't do, you cannot do anything. So these things happened a lot and lot and lot in history. Like, do you guys know about WikiLeaks? Julian Assange, WikiLeaks.
No clue.
No clue. Okay, so WikiLeaks is a organization started by this Australian guy, Julian Assange. So what he does is he finds corruption in top level countries, including US, and he puts up the all the data that he collected. He gives to the actually global world famous newspapers like Guardian, BBC, CNN, IBN, to all these guys. He just gives out the data. So like it happened in 2009 or 10, like he was targeted by all the country governments, and but they cannot find him. He keeps moving, he keeps roaming countries and all, and then he freezed all the bank accounts in all the countries. So these things and all happened, and but Bitcoin can give you that censorship resistance. Okay. Okay, so before moving to next slide, is this all good? Fine. Do you have any doubts? You can ask me quickly. Okay, I guess we are good. So, okay, so the history of currency, we have also almost covered it slide. So, initially we had barter system, everyone knows it. People exchanged goods for goods. So, I wanted to buy something, some food. So, I give something in return, another product. So, that's how it started, but then it's become very complex. It's hard to exchange things with the barter system, as you can imagine, and then we started inventing tokens and coins. Like what's the hard to reproduce item in the society? It could be some rare bird's beak, or it's a seashell, it could be anything. So we started using it, and then the durability of those tokens is becomes a problem, and then people wanted something that is durable, so I can pass it on to my generations, next generations also. And then we started using this gold, silver and other precious metals, and then we started for almost so many millennia, gold became the standard. Not even silver and all was got other utilities, other uses and all, and the gold was the one thing that was used as a currency for a long time in the human history. And then after paper came out, so we started issuing gold certificates. Let's say some trader in China wants to go to Europe and do some trading, and like he's a big trader, you know, like he wants to take some tons and tons of gold to do the trade. The problem is, like, when you are going from China to Europe, there are so many other countries who is having so many pirates and all. So it's very difficult to safeguard all your golds. So you need to take a group of mercenaries along with that. So just to transport your currency, you need to spend more money. So portability was a problem. And then so we introduced gold certificates. So that's the time, some 400, 500 years back, this banking industry started propping up. So what these banks told is, like, we have like our partners throughout the world. So you deposit your one ton of gold with me, and then I will give you a certificate signing this. By getting this certificate, any other bank could give one ton equivalent of gold to the person who is holding the paper. So suddenly everything got simplified. So the trader need not take all the 10 tons of money with some 10-20 mercenaries to safeguard it. He can just put it in his bag, and no one knows he is carrying 10 tons of money because it's in a paper. Okay, so that is how things started moving. And then the certificates, we started streamlining. So instead of giving certificates to each and everyone based on their gold measurement and all, government started pitching in, and they started doing standard, they streamlined the gold certificates. Actually, they streamlined, there can be some 100 value notes, some 500 value notes, like whatever, it's very close to what we are using now. So that's called the gold standard. So people won't actually use the gold, they started using the representation of the gold. So whatever currency, they are all backed by gold somewhere in the banks. So you can go to any bank at any point of time, give some paper currency, and then get back the gold for that. Okay. And then recently we started using fiat. Fiat. So do you guys know what fiat currency is? We all use it now. So whatever we are using it is fiat only. But any idea what fiat is? What it means? Guess no. Okay. So another question, like, do you think Reserve Bank of India is holding gold reserves for all the currencies that we are using, for each 1,000 rupee, 500 rupee. Like, how much reserves is there in our RBI? Someone?
No idea.
Good.
They do hold. They don't know the amount.
You don't know the percentage and all. But do you think they are holding some reserves?
Yes.
Okay, good. Okay, so fiat is a currency which is backed by nothing actually. Reserve Bank of India hold no reserves. US Federal Reserve holds no reserves. There is no requirement to have gold backups for the currency that is getting printed and circulated. So that is the fiat currency. Okay, so they changed the laws in all the countries some 100 years back, where the gold backup is not required. That's the fiat currency, and that is having huge problems, huge implications, which we'll be seeing in the next slide. And Bitcoin is not just an investment vehicle actually. Bitcoin is created to address the problems of the fiat currency, and also the side effect become a good investment vehicle as well. So now we'll just see the problems with the fiat currencies. Okay, so history of tax and inflation problem. So someone give me any rough idea, like what's the percentage of Indian population pays their income tax? Out of 1.4 billion people, I guess, how many people are paying income tax?
3 to 4%.
Okay, any other guess?
6%.
Okay. Anyone else? Any third guess? And then we'll see the actual number. Okay, so 3 to 4 and then 6%. Let's just Google it. Indian population paying. I think I Googled it frequently, so it's coming up. So this is what it is. 1.6% is paying income tax. So why I'm bringing up the point of income tax now? Okay, because it's a very interesting subject. So if you roll back some 100 years back, no country imposed income tax on the people. So every country had so many other taxes. Mostly it's called as VAT, VAT. Now it's named as GST here in India and other countries. So that is how the countries were running. They were collecting taxes from the businesses, corporates, but not from the people. And getting a percentage from individual citizens is considered illegal. So when some countries try to do that, it's none of the constitutions, none of the country's constitutions had any provision to collect tax from individual people based on their income. So, but when some countries try to do that, like people go to court and then say the court will decide this is unconstitutional, you cannot do that. There are exceptions where government collects tax and people also happily pay. Those are the times of war. When Germany and France are fighting with each other, like Germany will say, like, we are at war, we need to buy tanks, we need to give salary to our soldiers, we need to buy guns, we are out of money, can you please help by paying tax? Whatever you are, whatever income you are getting, you give us like 10% is the maximum percentage of income tax that was even collected during the war times. Okay, 2%, 5%, 10%, and immediately after the war is over, they will stop collecting it. That's what the history is like. There is something called Pollo case in US. If you Google about it, you will know. So after the US Civil War was over, like Abraham Lincoln, so he is a most loved president in the US history, right? So he asked for 10% and people happily gave it because for the Civil War. And after the Civil War, he stopped, and then the next president came and he thought, like, if we start collecting tax from everyone, it will be easy for us and all. And he put the income tax for the first time not at the times of war. And then this guy Pollock filed a case in the lower court, and then it went to the Supreme Court, and then Supreme Court smashed, saying, dear government, there is no provision in constitution to collect tax from the citizens, so you don't do any illegal things. So that was said to the government and they stopped it. And then in 1904 or something, amendment 16 came for the constitution, where all the political parties came together, and then amended the constitution, so now it constitutionally legal to collect tax, and that's how it, the tax started. I mean the income tax started in US, and then to every other country it came now. Because when US, we Indians got independence, we actually copied the constitutions from so many other countries. Ambedkar did that good job, actually great job it is, but everyone, the state is completely changed now. And one important point note here is, like, when US become a superpower, like in the late 18th century, they became a superpower without collecting income tax from the people. Okay, so that's how the world has changed. Like this is a problem with government tries to set up monetary policies and all. So I'm not saying don't pay income tax, I'm just saying the history, it's up to you to decide. Okay, and then inflation. So can you just tell me what is inflation? What do you understand by inflation? That's a word everyone hears of, but we might not know the actual definition, but at least some, any picture. Hello, how many of you joined?
Rise in price or demand something.
So, sorry, can you say again?
Rise in price or some kind of demand. I'm not really sure.
Yeah, rise in price is a consequence of inflation. That's a good understanding. But so okay, I will tell you what it's inflation. Okay. So right now, let's say Indian currency in circulation, INR in circulation, is probably like crores and crores of crores rupees. So let's not go into the actual number now. Let's say the whole Indian currency in print in circulation is 1 lakh rupees. Okay, 1 lakh is the actual currency that is in circulation in the whole world. So the rich guys, the richest guys like Ambani will hold 1,000 rupees. Like that is like 1% of the whole circulation. Okay, and government will hold some 5,000 rupees. Okay, so that is, the 5,000 is the 5% of the currency in circulation with which the whole government is running. So people like us, normal citizens, might be having like 1 rupee, 2 rupee. Okay, so you get the picture, right? Just for understanding, I reduce the scale. So the thing is, like, suddenly the government is getting into a war. Suddenly some natural disaster happens. Something happens. So as a individual, what you do when some unexpected emergency in your family, in your company is happening, means you, most of the problems are solved by money. So what you will do is you will go out and get loan from your friends, from bank and such. Okay, when some emergency is happening in a company, they will also go to a bank and then get money. But the government, from where they will go and get money? Okay, so they cannot suddenly put income tax and then people will go and pay and all. So that and all happened before, but right now what they do is they print their own money. So that's how it happens, is right? So government prints their own money. So that is the process of printing the money is inflation, and there is a percentage they allocate. So every year they will say, this year the inflation rate is 2%, this year the inflation rate is 5%. Let's say what that 5% inflation means. So I told you the whole currency in circulation is 1 lakh rupees, right? So 5% of 1 lakh rupees is 5,000. If the government is printing 5,000 rupees in this year, then they are saying it as inflation is 5%. Okay. So inflation in a controlled environment is a good thing. That's how economies can prosper, grow. Okay. Because we keep, population keeps increasing, new economic activities are happening, things needs to grow. So the currency in circulation cannot be fixed. So new currency needs to be created. But the problem is, when inflation is happening at 1-2%, that's totally fine. But inflation is going to too much percent, that's a huge problem. I will tell you in coming slides. And then there's the bailouts. I will also tell you that, give you that explanation in coming slides. And then the fourth point, I will come at the last. Okay. The fifth point is not related to inflation or anything. International remittance, which means anyone of you here who is not from India, like US, somewhere, Australia, somewhere in this session. If not, okay.
I am attending from Canada.
You are in Canada. Okay. Cool. So have you sent money to your Indian bank account or any of your friends, families in India? Do you send money?
Yeah, I did.
Cool. So if you send 100 Canadian dollars or whatever currency you have, $100 of your currency to India, how much money will be reaching there? Like, what's the percentage commission they will take? Do you have any idea?
Almost like 1,000 rupees in Indian amount.
Will be percentage, right? If you are sending $100, $100 is what? 7,000 rupees, I guess, right? So exactly 7,000 rupees won't go there. Some percentage will be taken. So how much do you know?
Yeah.
What's the percentage?
I don't know the exact percentage, but I think somewhere around...
Okay, in yesterday's session, I was asking one guy, like, he is in Singapore. He sends money to India. From Singapore to India, he says it's 0.5%. Okay, so if he is sending 1 lakh rupees, some 0.5 is what, 500 rupees will be taken as commission just for sending the money. Okay. This is between Singapore and India, where the infrastructure, economic infrastructure and the government policies are very good. They are friendly countries. But there are so many other, we have 194 or 6 countries. And at many of the countries, the remittance cost is so high. So if you are sending some money to some country in Africa, some 10-20% will be taken as charges, transfer charges. Okay, that's a huge problem. We'll see that in numbers later. And then, yeah, the current banking. Okay, the 6-7 points, I have separate slides. For now, I will just show you some small 30-second video. Before going into this, do you guys know in 2008, we had a huge economic collapse? US banks and all got shut down. They didn't shut down, they got collapsed, and it was a huge ripple across the globe. So many job losses, so many suicides also in US happened. So they call it 2008 economic crisis. Are you people aware of it?
Under Obama rule, right?
I don't know the exact presidentship.
Yeah, yes, sir.
Okay. Yes. So if you just Google, it's a huge history, huge mess up happened. So many movies also came out of this. Big Short is one good movie, like, where people predicted this going to happen. So it's about a movie where five people said in 2005 itself, US economy is going down, it's going to blast and all. So their story is taken as a movie. So after that happened, what happened is, like, government asked the Federal Reserve is like RBI, our RBI, Federal Reserve, to print some money to back up the banks that have failed. Okay. Backing up the banks, like, in that way itself is a huge problem, which we'll see shortly. But the problem is, like, the Federal Reserve printed so much more. Let's say the government asked them to print some $100 billion to back up these banks, but they have printed like $500 billion and then gave it to so much other countries and all. And then this is like our parliamentary session, BJP, Congress and all sit in parliament and then talk what happens, right? So like that, US politicians and then this federal bank head is sitting and then they are asking why you have printed so much money, so much inflated, you have so much inflation. At least tell us where all this money went. So he is asking that as a politician, okay, and then see the reply from the federal bank guy.
$2 trillion has been lent or spent, as the case may be. That's $4,000 for every man, woman and child in this country.
So if here is, he is saying we have printed $4,000 on every man, woman and child in this country.
Yes, maybe that's $4,000 for every man, woman and child in this country. Don't Americans have the right to know how you spent that money?
Yes, they have every right to know the purposes for which we spent it, the types of spending, the types of lending that's going on, how the types of collateral we're taking and what we expect to accomplish with that.
All right, well, specifically, I'd like to know how much was given to Credit Suisse and what you got in return. How much was given to Citibank, what you got in return. If you put out $50 billion to Credit Suisse, the taxpayers need to know that.
I'd be very...
Okay, so it's a huge video. I will share the slide again later. My point is, like, so US dollars is the globe's, all the nations' backing currency, right? So it is the currency with which other currencies are priced. But then the institution which is printing this actual currency is not disclosing how much currency, like, they are disclosing the numbers, how much currency, but for whom they have given the money, that is not disclosed till now. So people are saying, like, Federal Reserve is not a government organization, it's a private institution run by some other, I don't know, what happens there. The problem is with this fiat currency, which need not have any physical goods backing, people are doing some very big fun comedy things there. Okay, and it's all a open truth, but people don't understand all this. It's all super complex stuffs. Even the politicians who is asking that, I don't know, he is asking it for real or for the sake of the show, because no action has been taken. So there are so many other videos like this, I can share it all with you. Okay. So let's just go into this. So let me come back to inflation. So the problems with inflation, I told you like 1-2% inflation is needed actually for the economy to grow and all, right? But what happens when some, let's for the sake of discussion, 20% of new currency is being printed. Okay, let me just break it down. Let's say an A4 sheet paper is going into Reserve Bank of India building. Okay, and that paper note is coming out as some 4 2000 rupee rupee in currency notes. So which is like 8000 rupee value is came out. So before going into the building, it's a white paper A4 sheet. It has no value. You cannot even buy small 1 rupee candy for it. But then after going and then coming out of the building, it's now become 8000 rupees currency. You can buy what so much thing with it. So a paper got some value. So how that happened? From where that value came? A paper with which you cannot even buy a candy suddenly had a Gandhi's smiling face, RBI seal and all. But now the same paper, because it's printed, had some prints and all, it suddenly got some value. What's the logic? See, obviously, this is all some basic questions, right? We should have studied this in 5th standard. But no one explained us all this. We were taught what is photosynthesis. So many things. Trigonometry, algebra, but this is something basic, super basic. No idea? Okay, so I will tell you. Okay, I told you for the hypothetical situation where the entire Indian population, Indian currency in circulation is 1 lakh rupees, but now RBI has printed 20,000 more. So now it's like 1,20,000 in circulation. Yesterday it was just 1 lakh, now it's 1,20,000. So this 20,000 is like paper turned into new currency in RBI place only, okay, right now. So how this 20,000 got its value is, the remaining 1 lakh, its value is got reduced. So everyone who is holding the currency, the purchasing power of those currencies got reduced. So to connect this in a day-to-day basis, so some biscuit packet or something you would have bought in while you were studying as a kids, right? So I don't know how to say this in English. I'll just Google it. I should have prepared for it. So this is my favorite. It's not coming. Hello, am I connected to net? Hello, do you guys hear me?
Concern,
what is happening? Hello, do you guys hear me? Hello, someone, do you hear me? Hello. Hello. Yeah. I got disconnected. I am coming. Hello guys, sorry I got disconnected. Able to hear me? Now? Okay, Ashok says yes. Can someone say me verbally? I'll be happy to hear someone's voice. Hello? Do you guys see my screen now? Hello? Hello. I think you can't hear us. Okay, what happened? My speaker is free. But I am not able to hear you. One minute. Hello guys, can you, anyone of you talk? Just unmute and talk to me. I guess everyone is talking. I can see those dots, but I cannot hear anything. What happened? Give me 1 minute. Let me quickly disconnect and then join again. Can someone talk now?
I'm
able to hear you all now.
Cool.
I will present. Okay. Can see my screen now, right?
Yes.
Yeah,
cool. Okay, so coming to inflation in a day-to-day basis. So I am sure you people while studying in school might have bought some candies for some 25 paise or 50 paise, right? So do you know, so you also understand right now the price has been grown to some 1 or 2 rupees. Not just with those candies, for anything you have seen, like on earliest days your cable TV connection you might have paid some 50 rupees, 80 rupees per month, but now it's like some 200 rupees. Anything, your travel tickets, everything, the prices keeps growing, right? So you understand. So you know why that happens?
Inflation.
Exactly. So that is what inflation is. I told you, when a new currency is getting printed, when out of this 1 lakh in circulation, some new 20,000 is getting printed, the value of the remaining 1 lakh is getting reduced. Let's put it in another words. Let's say with this 1 lakh, you take the entire money in Indian circulation, all the INR, and then giving it to the Apple company asking for Mac laptops. Let's say for 1 lakh rupees, Apple is giving you some 1000 laptops. Tomorrow RBI is printing 1 lakh more. Now the entire India is having 2 lakh rupees. So with these 2 lakhs, if you are going and giving to the same amount to Apple, Steve Jobs won't give you 2000 laptops. Okay. So he will again give you only 1000 laptops. Why? Because you just because you printed money, you didn't produce any new economic activity, you didn't produce any new, found any natural resources, nothing is backed by it. You just printed it out. So which means new currency doesn't get value by itself, only economic activity gets value. So just because you have printed means you cannot get more laptops. So that means the purchasing power of the existing currency gets decreased. That is why whatever you bought in your childhood, you need to pay so much more now. So that's inflation in a day-to-day basis. What happens is like, so okay, the inflation is like, there are countries where inflation has gone super chaos. Okay, so India, China and all are like major stable economies where stupidity won't happen to extreme extents. But there are like 100 other countries, like small countries, where the politicians play games in such a way that, I will just show you Zimbabwe currencies. You should have a look at this or something. So what do you read? What do you read here? What's the value of the currency here? Do you guys see my screen? Hello?
$1 billion.
Yeah, it's a $20 billion. You can get a
$1 billion.
$20 billion.
Yeah, $20 billion. You can buy a coffee with this. So the thing is, there are so many other countries like Zimbabwe, Venezuela, Greece, and then Brazil, Argentina, where the politicians screw up the economic system, inflate so much. So in Zimbabwe, what actually happened is, like, in some year 2012 or 13, I'm not sure exactly, but something around that time, in January 1, to buy a coffee, you need to pay 10 rupees, okay? But the same year, the last day, December 31, to buy the same coffee, cup of coffee, you need to pay 5,400 rupees. So that much amount they have printed, they have inflated in that single year. So inflation gone out of the normal 2 to 3% is a mess. Like, everyone loses their lifetime savings in value. Like, the, let's say in that 1 year, some guy wanted to buy a house. He is saving some 1 lakh rupees for all his lifetime savings. So for some a decade, he is saving that 1 lakh rupees. Assuming in 2013, I am going to buy a house. But in 2013, the government prints so much money. Now, with that 1 lakh rupees, he cannot buy a house, but he can buy a Milk Bikis packet. So that is what is happening in so many other countries. So that's why inflation is a deadly problem when it comes to those countries. But with countries like US and India also, it's a problem that we will see in a decade time scale, not in a day-to-day basis, but still it's a problem. Okay, so other points I will see it in coming slides. So this is like the purchasing power of US dollars. Okay, the pricing, how it is, it's happened. So before 1971 is a line. If you see, before 1971, there is no fiat. Every currency in circulation is should be backed by a gold. That is how the rule of land is. Okay, so it was like during the times of war, things gets inflated, something happens, but then after the war, things get down. But this is the time when everywhere they change the rule, where they need not have any gold backing. They can print money as ever, how much they want. And then see, like, so see, this is like, so in 1800, to buy something, if you are spending $1, in 2019, to buy the same thing, you need to spend $20. So this is what happened after the link between the gold and the currency got split. This is like 1,117% of increase. Okay. Yeah. So, and then by printing this money, like, what's the one thing that government should not do at all, but they are doing, is like, let's say you are running a business, you are producing good products and you are having happy customers, which means your business will grow, you will have more customers, you will get more revenue. So for good performance, you are getting good reward. But let's say you have a business where you don't care about your customers, you are producing shitty products, no one will give to you, market will punish you, and your business will be closed. This is what basic market philosophy is, right? But if you are a multinational corporate, you are a super duper corporate, like all these companies that are listed here, you are doing bullshit strategies, you are not caring, taking care of people, and because of this, customers are not coming to you, some shit happens, and then you are about to close the company because you have no other way. For any businesses, this won't happen, but for all these multinational corporations, this will happen. What will happen is, government will print out new money and then give it to you, saying this is a huge company. Reliance is a huge company that is having petrol bunks all over India. If Reliance is doing a bad business move and then they end up like going bankruptcy and they are about to close it, so that will have a huge effect on Indian population if they are going to shut down all their petrol bunks. That's a negative side effect, of course, but obviously competitors will come and then they will patch the problem, right? But the government won't allow that company to get bankrupt and then get closed. They will print out new money and then they will give it to you. And this is a graph of, this is called a process called bailout. So bailout is like when one is about to go bankrupt, you print new money and then give it to that company. This happens only with big corporates, not with small businesses, citizens, farmers, nothing. Okay. So this is the amount, 7,983 per head of US population. So for every man, citizen and child in US, they have printed $7,983 to just give it to the corporations. So this is how corruption is happening in huge scales. in very high level governmental organizations, corporations, just because they have a fiat currency, they can print how much they want. So just because this TARP is current getting $826 billion, which means everyone in US holding the currency, they are getting their values reduced. They cannot buy the same item for the same price just because the government has printed more money. So that's what it is. So as I told, when you are transferring money between countries, so from London to Lagos, Lagos is the largest country in Nigeria, if you want to send $200, $26 is the transaction fee. From South Africa to Malawi, $40 is the transaction fee. So what percentage is that? 20%. 20% is taken as transaction fee, and the global average for international remittance to do cross-border transactions, the average amount is $13.8 for every $200, I am saying. So if you are going to send $400, it's going to be $26 as a global average fee. So the thing is, transfer of money, what it means technically speaking, just pure technical, is it's just some changing bytes in a server, some hard disk you are changing. In this account, reduce the amount. In that account, increase the amount. That is what you are doing. You are not actually moving tons and tons of gold, silver, nothing. No paper currencies are being moved. Nothing is happening. Everything is digital now. Okay. To send 1 MB of email with an attachment, image attachment, how much it costs you? Nothing. Absolutely nothing. Everything has become cheap. So digitally changing by bits and bytes doesn't cost anyone any money. But the problem is, why the remittance is still so huge, just to transfer money, just to change bits and bytes, why they are charging so much is, there is no competition here. When there is open competition, competitors will come with cheap products, better products, quality products. But when it comes to international remittance, there is only a couple of countries who are allowed to do that, Master, Visa, and only certain companies. They are like monopoly here. They have convinced all the governments to do that. So that's why it's like, when there is no one else there to sell dosa in your city, Saravanabhavan will make some 1,000 rupees dosa. You have no other option. Okay, no one is giving you 100 rupees dosa, 200 rupees dosa. Only Saravanabhavan is giving 1,000 rupees dosa. So if you want to eat, you need to pay that only. So there is no free market when it comes to this international global level currency transfers. So that's why we are having so much margin taken by these companies. Okay, so other ill effects, like, banking is an institution which is like a social, we couldn't see it as a private company, because it brings up people, it needs to provide loans to the students so they can get education, right? It needs to give loans to small entrepreneurs so they can solve problems, they can produce goods for the local society and such. But the problem is, like, if you see, in 2018, 1.7 billion people are unbanked, but 1.12 billions of them are having even mobile phone. So the technology has reached them, but the banking industry haven't reached them. So all these 1.7 billion people, their children could not get a bank loan to go to school or college. They are in, like, split across in African villages, even Indian villages and all. So this banking industry, who is supposed to act as a social institution, who is supposed to serve everyone in the planet, they are not doing it, because just like any other private industry, they are going only after the customers who is giving them profit. Okay, I'm not blaming them, that's how any company does, but banking should not be such a thing, right? So they are leaving out so many people just because they are in some different demographies. And then, yeah, even though none of you might have had a clear 2-mark understanding definition of what inflation is, we all intrinsically understand what inflation is. Whatever money I am holding now in my hands, in my bank account, in 10 years the value is going to reduce. Everyone understands this intrinsically, right? So because of that, people don't believe in savings, because whatever you are going to say, it's going to reduce in value only. So this consumerism, this materialism, everything, like, just go shopping, because at least material, like, I will be happy to have something, but if I'm having everything in cash, it's going to depreciate, right? So this is some stat. In 1970, 12.66% of the that's the percentage of savings people used to do, but now it's dropped to 3.39%. It's all direct effects of inflation. Even though people don't understand what exactly inflation is, people can see what happens. my grandfather did, my father did, like how much time spending things like, okay. Okay, this is one important, amazing thing. Anti-money laundering. So you guys know what AML anti-money laundering is? Anyone? I need to check often if I am connected with everyone. You people are here to hear me. Hello?
Sai, we can't see your screen.
From when?
For past 5 to 10 minutes.
No, no one can see?
I am able to see the screen. I don't know whether it's a problem with your end. Okay.
Anyone else can see? Anyone else cannot see? Okay guys, it's 9 o'clock already. So I need to quickly run. Okay, I am asking what is AML, is anti-money laundering. Do you guys heard about that? Okay, I will tell you, anti-money laundering is a law in almost all the countries where they say we need to print money, where the government say I need to print money, we cannot have gold, we cannot have such things, we need to have complete control because we need to have these laws like anti-money laundering laws and all because the terrorists should not make use of the money, so we should have complete controls, we should handle the monetary policies and all because it should not go into the bad hands. Okay, so that is what the purpose of anti-money laundering is. But let's just see what actually happens with it. I'm just opening just a Google search. I have searched anti-money laundering success ratio. So how success is those laws which is backing the actual inflation policies, and now I see this. Do you guys read? Can read this? Can someone read this for me? Hello? Hello?
Yes, I'm yeah. Sai.
Can someone read it? Whatever I have selected here in green.
In 2019, banks paid more than $6.2 billion for AML fines globally.
Yeah, so AML is a law to protect currency to going into bad hands. But then why banks are paying the fines? Any idea why banks are paying the fines? It should be terrorists who should be caught. It should be the bad companies, corporations who is using the money for bad purposes who should be fined, right? But why the heck banks are paying the fine? So I will give you another link for that. So Cobra Post is a very big scam that came out in some 2013, 14 or something time in India. Do you have guys heard about it? Cobra Post. Okay, I will give you a quick summary. Cobra Post is a scam uncovered by this. This is like a publications. Cobra Post is like Times of India, Hindu and all, some news media. So what they do is like they go to bank, speak to the bank manager. I have 5 crore, 50 crore black money. I cannot directly use it because I haven't paid tax for some 20, 30 years, or I have imported it from some foreign countries. So I need to convert it to white money. So what happens is these bank managers, they know everything, right? They know financially everything, how to convert black money and white money. So they just ask you to deposit the money. They will take some 10-20% cut. The bank managers, individual persons, will take some cut, and then they will somehow do some black magic and then put it in your bank account as a white money. So this is what a scam that Cobra Post has uncovered. Okay, and then bank managers cannot do that without violating the RBI rules. So to do that, they have to violate, and all AML rules are violated by the banks to support all the criminals. So there is a hearing in the cryptocurrency community. What they say is like, criminals don't use banks to violate currency laws. They own banks. So I'm not sure how true it is, like who is the people running the banks and all, but if you see all these news, you will come to the conclusion like how come banks are doing all these things for these companies, for these big guys. Probably they are having some shares in the bank and banks have no other option to go. So this is the case. And then if you see it's the anti-money laundering success ratio, if you see all these things, like the success ratio is less than 1%, 99% this law is failing. But these are like some laws with which the governments are backing the inflation policy, but then it's all like it's a 99% failure. Okay, right. Okay, so till now, any questions? Any gap in understanding?
Hi.
Yeah. Tell me.
Last point, were you trying to say that banks are the ones who actually are involved in money laundering?
100%. I am saying that.
Okay.
Based on the data that I have seen. So you just look at some YouTube videos on actual Cobra post, how that happens.
Yeah, okay.
Okay, and it's not just in India, everywhere. If you follow WikiLeaks and all, you will clearly know.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Fine.
Yeah. Okay, so when it comes to Bitcoin, Bitcoin has a strong privacy side, but it's also pakka open ledger in some way, open accounting system in some way. So the anti-corruption case for Bitcoin, so I don't know any how many of you are into NGO space, I'll just quickly run through this. So there is something called PM CARES Fund. If any natural disasters happen, if you want to donate to the needy people, you can always send to PM Fund, PM CARES Fund. They will take the money and then distribute to the needies, okay? And so many corporates are also giving to PM CARES Fund because they get tax exemptions if you are donating to this. But then some RTA activists last year filed a RTA petition asking for details on how the monies are getting spent. Are they effectively using it or they are doing some corruption there also? And then the PM CARES Fund response is like, we cannot disclose. Okay, so RTA is supposed to get all the any information we should be able to get. And this is like donation. I am giving my money, so I need to know where the hell it is going. But then the institute told I cannot disclose it. So it's just the case with any government department. You cannot get the data, especially the financial data, how the money is getting handled. But the government is the one who is supposed to have 100% transparency, not privacy. It's the people who needs to have their privacy, but it's all inverse now. Like whatever the people are doing, the banks, their statements, the governments can easily see our statements, where we are spending what and all. But what the government, how they are spending, we cannot see it. So Section 4 is an RTA Act procedure which says the government institutions should proactively publish all their activities online. So we should not even file a RTA application to see any data. So there is no way the current system will enable this. It will only remain a law. But when it comes to Bitcoin, everything is transparent in a way, as I told. I'm not going into the details, but to achieve the Section 4 of RTA Act, Bitcoin is the only option now. So in Bitcoin, you can see in one account what transactions happened, in which date, how much currency came, where it is going, and all. Okay, so it's transparent in one way, but it also gives you privacy in another way. So we should, like, as people of this country, we should enforce the government to make use of Bitcoin so we can see at least what they are doing. Okay, so we are saying Bitcoin is the next generation money. We started with barter system, tokens, coins, and then gold standard, gold certificates, gold standard, and then the fiat currency, which is backed by nothing. And then we are saying Bitcoin is the next generation money. So some properties of it, non-inflationary, that's the core problem. Government keeps printing, right? So next generation of money should be so stable. So they produced it like a deflationary currency. So if you have some 1,000 rupees now, with 1,000 rupees, you can buy what? Some 2 pizzas. But in 10 years, you should be able to buy 10 pizzas. So that deflationary currency, as time goes, the value should increase. They have designed in Bitcoin in such a way. And then confiscation is not possible. Government cannot come and seize your money. Borderless transactions. So when it comes to email, do you ever think like I'm sending to a guy in next street, and then that has some effort to send money to someone in Delhi, that has a different effort to send some mail to someone in Canada or US, that has some more effort? We don't think in such a way that, right? So in internet, globalist, everything is the same place. Whether it's a mail to Antarctica, New Delhi, US, it's all the same. There is no border, there is no geography. So currency should be the same. So to Pakistan, to Antarctica, to Germany, there shouldn't be no distinction, because end of the day, it's just a change of bits and bytes in some computer servers. So why should it have all these things and then allows everyone to use, like 1.2 billion population, this banking industry is not serving, so we should serve them and then we should have our privacy for us. Government is having their privacy, I don't know why the heck, but we are not having our privacy. Government can always see our bank details and all, so we should have that as citizens. Only owners can make transactions, as I said, confiscation, right? So government is able to confiscate your money and then they can do transactions and then much secure than bank. Banks are getting hacked, okay? Banks are end of the day is having some SQL code running inside. For who are those developers, programmers here, they know how bad SQL is. Like anyone with admin access can change whatever data. So banks are getting hacked. Censorship is not possible, as I told. Instant transaction. So if somebody is transferring money from US to India, it will take 1 day, 2 days. If you are transferring on weekends, some Saturday, Sunday, gone, 4 days it will take. But when it comes to Bitcoin, it's just as simple as mail. It will go immediately. Unlimited transaction, there is no cap. You can send how much amount you want, and the transaction cost is low. Like I said, like some between two countries, like there was 20% transaction fee rate. So it's not like that. It's a flat fee, actually, very low fee. Unlimited, you can send how much money you want, easy to use, and then you can send it anytime, literally. Sunday festivals, there is no festivals, there is no holidays to Bitcoin. It runs throughout the thing. Okay, there is a quick comparison of different currencies that we have by their properties. Durability, how durable gold is, like the gold that Akbar used, that Tiruvalluvar used, we are still using it. That same gold, I mean. So it had stood millennia. How durable is fiat? You can just tear it up and then throw it away. It's gone. So Bitcoin durability, technical problems are there. So we are giving some B score, but it's all improving. Software always improves, evolves, right? So Bitcoin is, it keeps on improving. Portability, how easy it is to move gold, very difficult to move gold, especially in big lumps. Fiat is easy, comparable to gold, but still it's way hard when you are moving $1 billion. But Bitcoin doesn't know $1 billion or $1, it will send instantaneously. Fungibility, I told, two different units of currency, like, are they having same values? Even Bitcoin, since it's a digital form, government can say this Bitcoin has been donated to Al-Qaeda. So see where this Bitcoin is going. So that will have a security problem attached with it. And then how easy is to verify when you are handed over a gold? Like, can you tell that gold coin has how much percentage of copper just by looking at it? No, it's difficult. Same with fiat, like you have duplicate currency notes and all, but Bitcoin is easily verifiable since it is digital. Divisible, so how you have a bar of gold, how many small units you can cut it into, it will be difficult, right? Fiat, okay, the government has given us so many small paisa and all, so that's better. Bitcoin is super duper divisible. One Bitcoin is equal to, just like how rupees paisa is there, for each rupee can be split into 100 paisas, right? So just like that, one Bitcoin can be split into 100 million satoshis. So one Bitcoin is 100 million satoshis. So there is so much divisibility there. And then scarcity, fiat is not at all scarce. The actual fact is, last year, because of COVID thing, US government printed 20% of US dollars in circulation. So that is going to depreciate not just US dollars, because every other nation's currency is connected to US dollars. Every other currency's value is going to go low at a super duper rate. Like even before 2008, so many economists said the world entire economic system is going to collapse. Our Rajan or someone, right, our RBI ex-governor, he wrote a book on that, because how these central banks are acting, the entire economic is going to collapse, and this is accelerating. And then scarcity, Bitcoin is only 21 million Bitcoins can come out, and 19 million always came. There's an algorithm, no one can change the algorithm. So it's a fixed supply, you cannot change anything. Established HT, gold, it's used for thousands of years. Fiat, every country has its own HT, 50 years, 100 years. But then no fiat currency stood the test of time. 500 years, no nothing. Established if Bitcoin, very recent, 10 years, so we need to wait and see. Censorship resistance, this is the only thing that gives you that, other things no. Okay, so as I said, from the investment perspective, just two more slides. So investment perspective, so this graph, I will just show the graph at this side now. Okay, so people might have seen Bitcoin's values keeps changing. Sometimes it's $45,000, sometimes $50,000, sometimes it's $40,000, 45, 50, 55. It's a huge change, right? So that's how Bitcoin is like, because it's a new currency, people are buying, selling, so many things happening. But this graph shows you in each year what's the worst performance, what's the maximum peak value. It's not that graph, is the worst performance, what's the minimum value of the Bitcoin in each year. In 2012, you can buy a, at the worst case, you can buy it at $4. You could have bought it and sold it at $4 was the minimum value of Bitcoin. And then it grown. Like in 2012, it might have orbited between $4, $5, $10 and such. But then 2013, its price has grown so huge, like it's now $75. So which means if you have invested 4 lakhs in 2012, you can sell it at 75 lakhs in 2013. So 4 lakhs to 75 lakhs. Wow, that's super. We didn't know. In 2012, anyways, in 2014, 75 has tripled, almost tripled to $200, and then it went down, and then it gone, it's doubled in another year, and then again it's got doubled, and then got tripled to 3,200, and then small increase in 3,400, and then again small increase in 3,700. Now, do you know the current price of Bitcoin now, anyone?
No.
So in Indian rupee, yeah, it's, I don't know the current rate. So in dollars, it's $49,000. $49,000 in Indian rupee, 37 lakhs. Okay, so let's stick with dollars now. So right now it's $47,000. Last year, its worst performing time was $37,000. So if you just look at the worst performing time of Bitcoin itself, if you see in the long run, in a decade, I don't know, if you have invested 4 rupees, just some 4 candies, you could buy so many pizzas in 10 years, right? So why its value keeps increasing is like, it gives the people what the only the government and the multinational corporates are having. Privacy, instant transaction, no questioning. So all those things, Bitcoin is giving the common man, normal people. So people are adopting, so the demand is increasing. But there is only fixed supply, but the demand keeps increasing, so the value is increasing. So how the users are coming to this? First, initially the cyberpunks who understand the political inflation drama, economic drama, whatever these governments are doing with the money, they are totally upset. They wanted to invent a new neutral currency system, and they invented it, and they are the initial users. And then the liberalists. Liberalists are like we have right, left politics and the like. So liberalists is a political group who is against this Amendment 16, which invented income tax. So they are against government controlling the economic system. They believe market should do the economic system. So they started coming in, and some techies who are like friends and relatives of this cyberpunks, and the Gen Z investors, all the kids, all the 15-year kids are now actually started using Bitcoin, because they don't have a bank account. They need to go have an age of 18, but they started developing and then deploying their startups at the age of 12, 15, and for their startups they need to have a currency. Governments are not giving bank account, so they started using cryptocurrencies. And then in 2017-18, Bitcoin came mainstream, like almost all the people on planet Earth at least started hearing the term Bitcoin, and stock traders are all started moving it to Bitcoins. And then this is the place where we are at, E&F, institutional investors, startups and corporates. So hedge funds, so there are so many hedge funds where those companies are like investment companies. So those companies start. Yeah, tell me. Hello, someone? Okay, fine. So these institutional investors started coming in past 1 year, and then so many startups, small companies started investing in Bitcoin. And then I guess most of you people are heard about our Elon Musk invested 2% of Tesla's cash holdings, which is like $1.5 billion, and bought some 42,000 Bitcoin some 2 weeks back. That's a huge thing. And there is a rumor, I'm very clear, there is a rumor that Google, Amazon, Oracle, Apple, everyone is looking at putting their money in Bitcoin. Why? Because their cash balance is going to be depreciated. Government is going to keep printing. So that's a problem for them also, not only us. So they are planning to convert to Bitcoin. Okay. And then actually some governments right now, like Pakistan government started doing Bitcoin mining in just last month. And there are some other governments who started regulating Bitcoin, started attracting crypto Bitcoin based startup companies to their countries. Why? Because they think all these huge economies, they are all cheating on them just by printing money. So they wanted to jump to a stable currency. So once this corporate startup started moving in, eventually government should follow. Okay, so governments doesn't follow, governments always follow these business people. That's how regulations, everything happens. So this is about to happen. But the problem is, so okay, the problem I will tell in the next slide. And then there is, how about other cryptocurrencies? So if you see here, where is that? So this is the coin market cap, which lists the price of all cryptocurrencies. So I don't know how many, what's the count, where they are showing the count. And no, actually literally, so yeah, here they are listing like 4,200 currencies. There's a Dodo coin, Bitcoin, Gold, Sala coin, Venus coin, Holo coin, whatever, Hasd coin, Bancor coin, Ontology coin. There are so many other coins because Bitcoin told the developers, like I'm a developer, Bitcoin told me you can create a currency by writing code. So every developer like me started deploying their own currencies. But then which currency will have value? That's the big question. Like Bitcoin is the leader. Bitcoin have all the properties. Everything else is like shit coins. We call everything else as shitty coins. And my strong suggestion is don't even look at what the other coins are. Okay, it's all stupidity. Yeah, and some few pictures. So I told you like some companies started investing in Bitcoin in past one year, right? But all, most of the companies back in 2016 17 18 told like they are like the pro market, like king of economics. They are the god of this thing, this economics, these investments and all. Suddenly some techies are coming and then saying, so Bitcoin is the cool new currency, borderless transaction, low transaction fee. No company will accept it. Warren Buffett won't accept it. So like BlackRock is such a company which says clients have zero interest in crypto. Our clients are not at all interested in crypto. That's what they said in 2018. Okay, now what they are saying in 2021, BlackRock filing some filing that they are doing with the IT department suggests that asset management giant could buy Bitcoin futures. So based on their IT filings with the government, some suggestions are there, like they might get into Bitcoins. So there are more pictures of this, like, so Independent magazine says cryptocurrencies are about to become worthless. This is said in 2018. And in 2020, what they are saying is Bitcoin performed 10 times better than gold in 2020. And then Jamie Dimon, the CEO of JP Morgan, that's a huge investment money company in US, they say Bitcoin as a fraud. He is not saying anything, monetary value will go to zero. He is saying it as a fraud in 2017. And then in 2021, JP Morgan, his company, says Bitcoin could go to $146,000 in the long term. Right now, the value is like $46,000, right? So he's saying $100,000 might increase in the long run. And there is another prediction by the same company which says it can even go to $650,000. Why? Because as more people come into the system, the demand is getting more, but there is a fixed supply. So that's why value keeps increasing. Visa CEO says we won't process transactions in Bitcoin because it's not even a payment system in 2018. But right now Visa signals further crypto ambitions with API pilot. So they just started integrating the Bitcoin things and all. So yeah, there are so many other things which I can send you later. And where is my slide? My plans. Right. Okay, the main slide. So far any questions? If not, we'll quickly finish this and then we can go to the actual Q&A session. Maybe I'll do that. So Bitcoin is highly volatile. As I told you, in the long run, it keeps increasing, which is good. But in the short run, let's say tomorrow you are putting 1 lakh rupees and in a week, it might drop down to 50,000. Okay, so that's how it is volatile. It keeps jumping and then dropping. And then exchanges, Zepay, Vazirex, Unocoin are the exchanges here in India, like that every country is having some fight in exchanges. Every exchange is getting hacked once in a while. Every year I see some 5 to 10 exchanges getting hacked across the globe. So you should not keep your Bitcoins in your exchange, otherwise it might get hacked. And then Bitcoin is still not a proven currency. Just like gold, it's a software that was written some 10 years back. The algorithms, the science behind it, the maths behind this is rock solid. but the implementation of it might have bugs. As a developer, I know whatever we write, that's having huge number of bugs. So whatever money you are going to bet on it, you are going to bet on software developers, so beware. And the technology is still not ready to go mainstream. Like the technology is not ready to bring on all the 7.4 billion people. There are so many technical infrastructure level problems are there. I'm not going into the detail. And then they are saying what it's instant transaction, but it's not actually instant. You need to wait for 1 hour. Some 6 confirmations needs to happen before you can confirm I have received it or I have sent it. And then the government regulations. So I told you, government is doing inflation, government is doing bailout, government is doing that, this and all. But with Bitcoin, they cannot do anything because it's algorithm. No one has control. It's all written. Prices will be fixed by market. Government don't have any role at all in managing this. So that's a problem with government. Okay, the government guys won't accept it. So they might bring regulations which will ban Bitcoin. So those things and all will happen, might happen. But if you are going to invest it, then how you are going to handle the situation, we'll see. And then, yeah, this is one key phrase that not your case. Okay, don't invest more than what you are afford to lose. So if you are investing some 10,000 rupees, it should be like, if this 10,000 rupees is going to nothing, it's not going to impact me, then you invest that amount. Don't invest more than what you are afford to lose. Okay, so based on the current transaction fee, commission charges and all, my suggestion is to not to put anything less than 1 lakh. For trial, yeah, you can put 1,000, 2,000, but for actual investment, for long term investment, don't put anything more than 1 lakh. And then as I said before in this presentation, I am not covering anything related to how to go to exchange and then buy it, how to secure your coins in your wallet, what is software wallet, hardware wallet, how to back up your keys at all. It's a huge process. I need to share my screen and then show my softwares, show my mobile phone, show my hardware wallet is like a pen drive. That's the most secure thing on the planet, which can save your Bitcoins in a safe way. I'm not covering you all that, but I'm planning for a separate session for that. I will post more info in group. So if at all you are not attending my session, you are going to try on your own. The key thing that you should have your mind is like every wallet will have a 12 or 24 word key phrase that you should have backup. So if you are not taking it, then you might lose your money. So Bitcoin gives you so much. It empowers each and every individuals of the planet in handling their things without the government doing all the dirty things. So it gives you great power, and that comes with a great responsibility. So taking care of all these things. Again, whatever I said, I am not a economic student. I am not a PhD in finance. It's all my personal interests. I am following so many things and I have tried out so many things. I have, in the process, I have lost also some money and all, so many things happen. So I'm just sharing my experience, whatever I have learned for these 4 years. So don't just go and invest believing Sai has said something. He's shown some graph and all. So do your own research, consult your professionals before investing. Thank you guys. Hey, give me a clap and then start your questions. Hey.
Thank you, Sai.
So yeah, Q&A, what questions do you have?
Sai, one question. Yeah. You say other coins are bullshit, right? So
exactly.
What is the reason, exact reason? So Bitcoin is already established and everyone aware of that.
Yeah.
Other coins are not yet established. So there's more chance, right, to upgrade in the future.
So more chance for what? So Bitcoin is a clear case, right? Bitcoin is a clear case. Like the case is like government is doing inflation with all their national monies. So Bitcoin want to become a global currency, global money where anyone on the planet could make use of. So let's say Bancor coin. So how Bancor coin is going to compete with Bitcoin? Or take any one coin that you know, you have invested or you have studied about, take that coin and then put it in this chart and then compare and then tell me, okay, there is another coin which is getting A plus in all that, then of course that we should all go for that coin. So you should have a fundamental study like this before even trying to put in any coins.
How this is determined, sir?
Which one, man?
This ratings. So others also we can buy and we can exchange. So
yeah.
How it is different from Bitcoin?
So yeah, just just let's say verifiable, okay? So it's all software, right? You can read about that coin and then you can see if it's verifiable or not. You can see if it's scarce, like I will show you here. So Bitcoin circulating supply is 18 lakh. But I told you the maximum cap it can go is only 21 lakh. More than that, it won't come. But with these things, but there is a progress bar if you see. Like this progress bar, so much amount is filled. Remaining is there. So that is like getting printed for a while. So remaining 3 lakh is yet to come. But with Ethereum, there is no cap, which means there is no fixed supply here. Like this also can be inflated. So it's not scarce. So in the scarce property, if you put Ethereum, it won't get A plus. It might get A, it might get B. It's probably better than fiat, but it's not as good that good as Bitcoin. So Ethereum is no in terms of scarcity. So like that, you need to understand each coin and then put it in the graph. The thing is, like I am summarizing, I have did these things with other coins in 2017 and 18, and then it took me so much time to understand. Everything else is bullshit. We need to talk one day to make you understand that. It's hard to explain in short time.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, anything else?
Sir, I have a doubt.
Yeah, tell me, Rob.
Can we use Ethereum to buy a Bitcoin?
Of course, within cryptocurrencies, each cryptocurrency is easily transferable. You can easily buy Bitcoin with Ethereum, Cardano, Binance Coin, Tether, Polkadot, I don't know. And you can easily buy Tether with Binance Coin, Cardano, Ethereum, Bitcoin. You can easily buy XY Coin with all other coins. It's so easy.
So it is exchangeable.
Yeah, exchangeable. But with each exchange, the exchanges will be taking their commission.
Even in cryptocurrencies.
Yeah, even between cryptocurrencies. Of course, that's their job, that's their business role, business model, right? Next question. Yeah, I think I should answer you guys this. Like, what if the Indian government bans Bitcoin? Like, you are all attending the session.
I had the question.
Yeah, your question, please.
I had the similar
question.
What
okay.
If we have already invested in Bitcoins and the government, Indian government suddenly bans it?
Yeah,
so
yeah.
What about if we
so again, I am telling you my personal perspective, my own opinion. For that, I need to show you a picture. Yeah, this one I have written in November 2, 2017. Okay, that time when this news came. War on Bitcoin, government panel seeks crackdown on cryptocurrency dealers in India. So if you see, it's like the same. India is planning to ban cryptocurrency in India. And this came out, if you see, November 2, 2017, right? Actually, then I started digging past, and from 2016, they started saying this. Bitcoin is going to be banned in India. And even now they are saying this. Last parliamentary session, we were expecting government will actually speak something in the session. But they have not opened their mouth on the session. So next month section, I don't know whether after 3 months, 6 months. So the thing is, government don't understand Bitcoin, but they see it as a threat only because they cannot inflate it. They cannot do the bailouts for the big corporates. So they cannot do any of the dirty things that they are doing. So which means they are losing power. So they won't embrace, they won't happily go and hug Bitcoin. Hey, Bitcoin, come on, we all do the world, take the world to a better place. So they will have their eyes on Bitcoin, but if they are banning, that will be a huge problem. Why? Because now that Elon Musk and so many companies started investing, putting money in Bitcoin, they are saying like whoever bought some 1,000 Bitcoins in 2014-15, people could have easily bought 1,000 Bitcoins. All those people are going to be billionaires in some next 5 years. And the world's top billionaires are going to be cryptocurrency holders. Okay. So you are banning something which the top billionaires of the planet, the top 1,000 billionaires of the planet are having cryptocurrencies, and India is banning cryptocurrency, which means no investment is going to come to India. So that and all is in a 10 year timeline. But right now, if India is banning, obviously we are a democratic country. So, and they know, like there are like Vazirex is saying like 140 million users have bought Bitcoin and all. So government will give us some time or something. So this is like worst case hypothetical scenario. I don't think Indian government will actually ban it, since so many others are embracing it. So they will give us some time. So in 3 to 6 months, return all the Bitcoin to us and we will give some money, the same, the value, whatever value it is in return. So that is the worst case I am expecting. But my opinion is like they will just keep saying this story till US and European countries brings a strong regulation which we can easily copy. So we won't bring the first strong regulation. We will wait for the other countries to bring their regulation and we will copy it. That's what I'm believing.
Sai, I have one more question. So in other countries, they're getting tax also. I came to know, is that true?
Yes, boss. Only in India. Only in India also you need to pay tax, boss. Not only in other countries. But
now we are paying tax for buying Bitcoin.
No, I will tell you. Every asset, whatever you hold, which appreciates in value, you are getting some income from it. You are supposed to pay tax, right? But the problem is in India. India don't have any clear regulations on how to pay tax for cryptocurrency gains. So they have categories that as cryptocurrency falls under capital, some capital assets. So even in capital assets, there are divisions like short-term capital, long-term capital and such. So it's not very clear. Like I have consulted some 5-6 auditors and no one knows how to handle tax for cryptocurrencies. So it's nothing to worry about now, in my opinion, again. Come on, next.
Sir, I have a question.
Yes.
Are they still doing crypto mining?
Of course, man. Crypto mining is the thing that keeps the entire network running. If people have started crypto mining, then that's it. But I change your question to something else. I think you are trying to ask, is crypto mining still profitable? Is that what you are trying to ask?
That is also one more question.
Okay.
But yeah. Mining
is happening. Mining will always happen. Mining is the process which keeps the entire network secure. Otherwise, it's all gone. And the second question, like, is crypto mining, whether you can do Bitcoin mining in your system with your graphic card and all. Crypto farms in China. So I will show you a picture.
Yeah, I saw that one. I saw a crypto farm and it takes a large amount of electricity and all other things.
Yeah, so this is how crypto mining is actually happening. They take acres and acres of place and they install these ACIC, application specific integrated circuits, that will drain so much energy to keep the system secure. This is how actually happened. So with your single computer, with even i9 processor, 32 GB RAM, Bitcoin mining is not possible. But you can mine other currencies like Ethereum. I don't know which currency is profitable and all. I don't know. But there are other small currencies and all. You can try it out.
Okay.
But Bitcoin mining is... Okay. Bitcoin mining is not profitable at small scales now. You need to invest 1 crore, 2 crore rupees, set up a mining farm like this.
And there are countries among where they can ban this farms, right?
The thing is, China banned cryptocurrency mining in 2018, I guess. Okay. You should not do cryptocurrency and all in China. But then, still China is the largest crypto miner in the world. So the regulation didn't do anything.
Okay.
Just like with any other law. Anything else?
Sorry, which exchange you are suggesting Bitcoin trading and other currencies?
So okay, I usually don't answer anything related to exchange wallets and such, but I will answer this one. I am using Zepay personally.
Zepay,
yeah.
Okay.
Just
think about wallet, right, Sai? So you transfer that to your separate wallet.
Hardware wallet, yeah, definitely. You should not keep in exchanges. So guys, just for clarity, buying Bitcoin and then transferring it to your wallets, before transferring, setting up your wallets, that's a huge process in itself. If guys are interested, like at least if some 10 people are interested, I can take a session for that. But since that involves completely into actual investments, no theories, nothing, that will be a paid webinar. I'm not sure about the exact amount and all. So I'm also thinking like this, like let's have some X amount for the webinar, out of which some 20% of the X I will transfer it to you during the webinar itself, where in the session you will be setting up your own wallets, if not hardware wallets, at least software wallets, where I'll be returning money. So even if you're not going to buy in later, in the session itself you will have some experience of having a Bitcoin, having done a transaction and such. So you can have all your investment, wallet, transactions, actual practical part in that session.
Yeah, sure.
Anything else? So this is the first act. Mt. Gox is the big cryptocurrency exchange. It was founded in 2010, 1 year after Bitcoin was introduced, but it got hacked in about 2013 or 14. Mt. Gox announced that approximately 850,000 Bitcoins belonging to customers and to the company were missing and likely stolen. So don't have any of your coins in your exchange. Anything more? We still have 15 minutes to 10, so feel free. I think if not, we can wind up. What you say? I'll just take a screenshot of this, just one photo.
Sorry, one more question. So, Bill Gates is opposing Bitcoin. Is it true, sir?
Yeah, he doesn't appreciate Bitcoin. He don't understand Bitcoin. I don't know. Actually, I am to introduce some person here. Saranan, just can you say hi? Are you there? Sarana?
Hi, sir. Can you?
Yeah.
Am I audible?
Yeah, yes. Hi.
Yeah, hi, everyone.
Yeah. So Saranan is my crypto partner. Like he knows more things than me. He's like 10 years more knowledgeable than me in this space. Like he understands the actual economics part, financial part, how the entire economic system works and all. So he is like my personal Bitcoin guru. So Saranan, do you have any opinion on Bill Gates and Bitcoin?
So personally, I think looking for opinions of celebrities, even including Elon Musk, Bill Gates, is not a good idea when it comes to choosing in investing. It's better to do our own research. That is the first thing.
Yeah.
So Bill Gates might have a different opinion. Elon Musk might have a different opinion based on their own background connections between their business models. Say, for example, Bill Gates is kind of more of an investor now. He invests a lot of money. In the current economic system, Elon Musk doesn't do that. He just does startups, do business, and do engineering stuff. So their incentive model is aligned a different way. So Bitcoin is completely a new thing. Probably Bill Gates doesn't feel that it is not adhering to his own investment portfolio system. So that could be one of the reasons. But these are all theories and assumptions only. Nobody knows what is the real reason why Bill Gates is opposing. All the reasons that he's sharing in the media is simple, obvious reasons that everyone is telling, not some unique narrations that Bill Gates is bringing into the table. So considering all this, it's better to do our own research, understanding the coins, what is the value proposition, is it really solving any problem, and is it really reliable, is it strong enough to do its own, support its value proposition. Then invest some money based on. Don't go for any celebrity's perception.
Yeah.
Even if it is positive or negative.
Yeah, and their perceptions, opinions change like this. 3 years back they are saying like this, 3 years back they are changing their opinion based on their newfound knowledge and such. So we should do our own so research and gather our own knowledge and then invest on this. Because you will never know what Bill Gates will say in 5 years, right? Okay, I think we can wind up, right? Okay, guys, thanks for joining. Happy to have every one of you. And I will share a feedback form in the group, WhatsApp group. Just please take some 5-10 minutes. I will post in some half an hour or something. If not today, tomorrow. Spend some 5 minutes in giving your feedback, okay?
Sure, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you, guys. Thank you. Bye, 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 bye.
Bye.
ஹலோ, உனக்கு தாண்டா அடிச்சுட்டு இருந்தேன். எவ்வளோ நேரம்டா பேசிட்டேன், ஃபோனே பார்க்கலடா. நான் ஆஃப் ஹவர் பேசினா கியூண்டே 15 நிமிஷம் தான் வந்தது. அப்போ 20 நிமிஷம் தான் வந்திருக்கு. பிராக்டிஸ் பண்ணல பிராக்டிஸ் பண்ணல. இந்த படம் காட்டுறது ஏதோ எனக்கு கம்மியான மாதிரி எனக்கு கடைசியில் அந்த போட்டோலாம் காமிச்சிருந்தா எனக்கு அந்த ஃபீல் வரல. பேசிக்கா எனக்கு அந்த ஃபீல் எமோஷன் லெவலில் இருக்கு, எக்ஸைட்மெண்ட் கொடுக்குற மாதிரி வரல அந்த கடைசி ஸ்டேஜஸ்ல. சொல்லிட்டேன் மாத்திட்டேன் சார், கேள்விப்பட்டதால கண்டிப்பா.